Good morning and welcome to the first meeting of Session 6 of the Public Audit Committee. I'm Colin Beattie, MSP for Midlothian North and Musselburgh, and as the oldest member of the committee, I have the pleasure of convening this meeting for the first three items of business. I'd like to take the opportunity to welcome all members, and I do look forward to working with you in the future in this committee. Before we move to the first item on the agenda, I'd like to remind everyone present is switched to their mobile phones to silent. Now, I understand no apologies have been received. So I'll move, first of all, to Agenda Item 1. Agenda Item 1 is a decision to take Agenda Item 6 in private. I'm assuming that everyone agrees unless a member indicates otherwise. So does any member object to taking Item 6 in private? Only raise your hand if you object. Members have agreed to take Item 6 in private. I'll move now to Agenda Item 2, and the Agenda Item 2 is for each of us to declare any interests we have that are relevant to the work of the committee. Now, background information is provided in the Declaration of Interest paper, is Paper 1. I will start by declaring my own interests, and then I will ask the members in alphabetical order to do similarly. I would declare an interest as a Director Trustee of the National Mining Museum of Scotland in view of the fact that this committee has a remit in tourism. I have no other interest to declare. I call on Malik Coffey.
Thank you, Convener. I have no additional interests other than those in my register, and those are that as a former Councillor on East Ayrshire Council, I am a former employee of Learning in Scotland, and I own a small number of shares in Kilmarnock Football Club.
Thank you. I call Sharon Dowie.
I own a heritable property and I have no other declaration of interest.
Thank you. I call Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Mr. Beattie. I'm an elected member of East Lothian Council and also a board member of the South East Scotland Transport Partnership.
Thank you. And lastly, Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Convener. I don't have any declarable interests, but for the record, I would draw people's attention to my voluntary register of interests, which includes financial support given to my local Labour Party by Unite the Union, the RMT, Unison, BWU, ASLEF and the TSSA trade unions.
Thank you. I'll now move straight on to Agenda Item 3, which is the most important item. The committee's next task is to choose a convener. The procedure is explained in the Choice of Convener paper, which is Paper 2. The Parliament has agreed that only members of the Scottish Labour Party are eligible for nomination as convener of this committee. I understand that Richard Leonard, MSP, is that party's nominee. Is that correct? No seconder is required. Do we agree to choose Richard Leonard, MSP, as our convener? Thank you. We are agreed. I'll congratulate Richard Leonard on his appointment, and I'll vacate the chair and hand over to him. Over to you, Richard.
Thanks, Colin, and thanks to everybody for your endorsement. I'm really honoured to be elected as convener of this committee. My role will be to work inclusively without fear or favour, to hold power to account, to promote the common good and the public interest, to be a guardian of openness, transparency and democracy, and through evidence and scrutiny, shine a bright light on public governance, public working practices, investment and outcomes on behalf of the people. Can I turn now to the next item on the agenda, which is the election of a deputy convener? And Parliament has agreed that only members of the Scottish Conservative and Unionist Party are eligible for nomination for this position. I also understand that Sharon Dowie is the party's nomination for this post. So do we agree to endorse Sharon Dowie's nomination as our deputy convener? If anybody disagrees, could they put that in the chat? I see no signs of disagreement. So Sharon, congratulations on your election as the deputy convener of the Public Audit Committee. The next item that we have to consider is the legacy paper, which has been circulated in advance of this morning's meeting. And first of all, can I ask the committee to place on record our thanks to the Session 5 Public Audit and Post-Legislative Scrutiny Committee for its legacy report. I'm conscious of the fact that two of our own members in this session were also members of the Session 5 Committee who played a part in putting together that legacy paper. The legacy paper clearly will be an important part of the consideration we need to give to our work programme. And I would just invite you know, any member of the committee, if you've got any comments wish to add anything in connection with the legacy paper, to indicate if you want to come in. If Willie Coffey. Willie.
Thank you, convener, and it's a pleasure to be back on the audit committee, and particularly with my friend and colleague Colin Beattie. Both of us have been a number of years service to the audit committee, and I really enjoy the work that we do. I've read through the legacy paper, convener, and there's a number of recurring themes that always seem to be in an audit report from one session to the next. And one of those issues is following up on our work that we do at the Audit Committee to try to engender a spirit of continuous improvement, let's say, within the public sector. I think the Audit Scotland and our committee did a lot of very, very good work, but sometimes, convener, I felt that we didn't see the outcome of that in terms of performance improvement and how the various public bodies in Scotland embrace audit to get that improvement. And sometimes I felt that the public bodies thought that we were there to punish them, and in fact we were an instrument of some torture. But we're not. We're there to provide opportunities for continuous improvement and to help public bodies. And I think a lot of the public bodies need to begin to embrace that. And for me, convener, I would like to be able to see at some stage in the work that we do some evidence of continuing improvement from the bodies that we shine our gaze on. I think that would be a good development of the work that the committee can do in this session, and I would very much hope to see a little more of that. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. That point's extremely well made, and I know that the legacy paper talks about the defensiveness sometimes of accountable officers who come before the committee, and I hope that we see maybe a changing approach from those people who are brought before the committee to give evidence. And as I say, we've got a job to do, and we are here to serve the interests of both Parliament and the people. And so we will do whatever is required in order to do that. But I think it's important that we do have an oversight of what happens in the future, not just maybe an issue or even indeed in some cases a crisis which has arisen. We need to have that kind of longer term reach. So I think that's a really well made point. I've also got Colin Beattie and Craig Hoy, so I'm going to call Colin Beattie first of all. Colin.
Thank you, Mira. There's really three areas within the legacy document that I'd like to look at more closely. One is the audit remit, which repeatedly has come up. Our remit as a public audit committee is less than the remit of the equivalent down in Westminster. We are more passive in the approach that we can take. We are limited to what the Auditor General might put in front of us. Whereas I think a public audit committee should have a more proactive approach instead of a passive approach. We should be able to, if necessary, initiate our own investigations. It's not going to happen often, but where necessary, it should. And I know that the Auditor General should be willing to put resources against that if it was required. It's not as if we're going to be launching an investigation every 5 minutes, but there's been occasions when we've looked at stuff and a more proactive approach from us, more drive, more push, might have got us better results. The second thing is, just specifically looking at the issues here, we're no longer responsible, I see, for post-legislative scrutiny, which I think is the correct way forward. It focuses us very tightly on the things that we need to look at. But there is one thing that we did post-legislative scrutiny that would like to find some way to bring forward into this session, and that's control of dangerous dogs. And there's ways to do that. We took evidence that something like 7,000 people are admitted to A&E every year and require surgical intervention due to dog attacks, and on some occasions children have been killed by dangerous dogs. And I've made the point before, if this was drunken driving, we'd have a policeman in every corner. But because it's dogs, somehow we seem to sweep it under the carpet. We need to address it. We need to protect good, sensible dog owners, and we need to deal with those that are not controlling their dogs, those that are not fit for the purpose of being a dog owner. And the third item was in relation to a specific investigation that we did into Bord na Gaeilge. Now, I know that the Auditor General will bring that back to us, but there's a huge amount in there that still needs to be investigated. I think there's serious issues in there, and I think these serious issues continue. And I would urge the committee to follow up on this and ensure that we get to the bottom of everything and that proper rectification of these issues is put in place. Public money is being spent. It's not clear it's being spent well. Thank you.
Thank you. And I think Bord na Gaeilge is still part of our continuing work programme. There are other public agencies like the Scottish Police Authority, I think a couple of NHS boards who are also within scope of our continuing work. And I think it's absolutely essential that there is a seamless transition from the last committee to this committee to make sure that nothing slips through the net. I also hear what you're saying about the post-legislative function of the committee, which isn't part of our remit anymore. So I think perhaps we can have a look at how best that that work that's been undertaken can be advanced, and whether it's advanced by us or whether it's advanced by another part of the Parliament, I think we need to examine that. And I think one of the most telling points in the legacy paper that struck me was the continued demand for a power of initiative for this committee, and so that we are not, I think, as you, Colin, described it, passive players in this, but we've got a role to take initiative ourselves. And I think there are ways under the current structure we can do that, but I think a more overt power to be able to do that is something that we should seek through the parliamentary opportunities we've got to try to secure as early as possible. I see that Craig Hoy wishes to come in, so Craig, over to you.
Thank you, Richard, and can I congratulate you on being elected as convener this morning. Just looking through the report, I picked up what I thought was a sense of frustration from your predecessor as convener, particularly in point four in the foreword, where they say we kept seeing the same issues again and again across the public sector: leadership challenges, poor workforce planning, weak governance arrangements, failed ICT projects, and an absence of key data, making it impossible to determine whether policies and initiatives were actually making a difference to people's lives. And I think maybe that is one observation that we should keep uppermost in our mind as we set out on the work programme today. And just 2 points in terms of the committee's prior recommendations, which I think might mean that we end this Parliament without that same sense of frustration. And one is in point 25, recommendation 25, that the incoming committee may also wish to consider inviting SPICE to prepare a briefing on mechanisms used in other jurisdictions to follow up on audit report recommendations so that we do actually have action beyond the identification of the problems that we will no doubt find. I think also, as has been alluded to by Colin Beattie, I think in relation to point 64 in the recommendations, that the committee recommends that the remit of the Public Audit Committee is reviewed with a view to enabling its successor committee to freely initiate its own inquiries. I hope that we can do that. And I think just a third observation really is obviously as we emerge out of COVID with the huge amounts of public monies that have been pumped into the economy, point 56 that was raised in the legacy paper in relation to ensuring that there's scrutiny of public money that's been used to support the economy and its recovery from COVID-19, and to examine what impact that's had on inequalities, including regional inequality in Scotland. So I know we'll come to that at the work programme later, but I just thought perhaps those three issues might mean that we don't end this Parliament with that same sense of frustration that I was picking up from our predecessor committee.
Thank you. And I think that there is a clear sense that we are going to be in very challenging times, especially for the public sector, and organisations from the National Health Service to the court system are going to be under incredible strain. So I think that there is I think the Auditor General has identified the importance of understanding the pressures that there are going to be, but to ensure that despite those pressures, good governance, proper working practices, workforce planning and investments that are made are effective ones. And so I think that's something that we will return to. I was also struck as well by the sense that the previous committee understood that we are not just dealing on a case-by-case basis with people that come before us. There are often common themes that run through and frankly, some systematic failures that need to be tackled, and I think it's important that we have that broader understanding as well, that sometimes we are dealing with some pretty pretty fundamental failings in the way organisations are approaching their remits, and that these can be common across the public sector. So I think we need to understand that there are at times common themes that we need to pursue and make sure lessons are learned not just by the single organisation that may be before us, but are learned right across the whole of the public sector. And I also think the recommendation that we do consider international experience is a really important one too, and I think that's something I'm keen that we pursue when we discuss the work programme. I see that Willie Coffey wants to come back in. So, Willie, I'll bring you back in.
Thanks very much again, Convener. It's basically on the following the public pound agenda there that Craig was talking about. We also know that because of the impact of withdrawing from the European Union, we're not quite clear where the scrutiny gaze will fall. And I'm hoping that Audit Scotland will give us a little bit of advice too. Prior to this, of course, we had some ability to see what was happening in terms of monitoring spend in Scotland from new European Union structural funds, for example, things like that. But I'm not quite clear if we'll have the same ability to look at things like the UK government's levelling up funds and all of various other funds that may replace those. So I think we need to get a little bit clearer, perhaps, convener, about what our role is, if we do have a role, a scrutiny role at all there. There will be substantial amounts of money basically being spent, albeit by a different jurisdiction, and I hope we have the ability to shine a light in some of that too.
Thanks, Willie. I think that point is really well made, and that there will be new funding instruments to support agriculture, to replace the European Union structural funds, the European Social Fund, and so on. And some of the detail of that, I think, still remains to be seen, but I absolutely think that it should be the job of this committee to scrutinise how that is being applied and whether or not there are reforms or improvements that can be made. I really do think it's important that we understand that there is a huge change taking place as a result of the UK's withdrawal from the European Union and what that then means for the landscape that people are facing. So I would like to thank members for those contributions. I think it's important that we got some of those points on the record as we are in public session. We are going to discuss our work programme in private session as previously agreed. And I think we're all clear that the legacy paper from the Session 5 committee will form an important starting point for us in considering what our work programme is going to be in the short term and medium term future. So if we're all agreed on that, can I bring this public session of the committee to a close and thank members for their contribution and look forward to a constructive and productive working relationship in the future. Call the public session to an end.